rather than it being a lecture in the kind of formal sense, I do have some tips, some writing tips to do with academic writing, especially for research articles and master's or PhD thesis. That's the kind of writing that I'm thinking about when I was preparing this presentation. But just before I start, I would be really happy if you could just introduce yourself to me very briefly. Just tell me your name and which faculty you work in and what kind of writing you are expected to do in English. So that would help me understand your needs as well. Okay. We won't need the computers as such, but I am hoping to use an activity that you'll be able to contribute from your phone rather than the actual computer. So don't worry if you're not logged in. If you have your phone and you're on the Wi-Fi or your data, you should be able to do a collaboration that way, but more about that later. So let's start over here. Will you just introduce?
Hello, my name is Andino. I'm visiting fellow from CPL, Center for Lifelong Learning. I want to write a paper about computer science.
Yeah. Hi, I'm Rini. I'm from FAS in English Literature. So my writing is mostly on literary studies.
Writing itself, but the actual skills that go around making that writing possible. So it's not necessarily just skills of English language, it's also skills of discipline and working to deadlines and so on, and various other things. So I want to just highlight what are the real key skills to make yourself a successful writer who can complete projects and articles effectively. So we'll think about the kind of skills around writing. And then we'll look at some points. I think I mentioned, if you saw the abstract for this workshop, there are some kind of frequently asked questions about specifically English academic writing, to do with style, to do with use of the first person, to do with verbs that are more varied than just discuss and so on. So we're going to be looking through some of those things together. That's what I hope will be really helpful for you, very, very practical, hands-on stuff. And then there'll be time for any questions that you may have relating to that, any discussion, any suggestions that you have, any specific advice you want, even if it's on a one-to-one level. There will definitely be time. We're scheduled right up until 4:30. So this will take us probably only till around 3:30, quarter to 4. So there's plenty of time for individual questions too, if you don't want to talk in the whole group. So there will be lots of time.
Okay.
So that's our plan. So I started off thinking, well, writing, academic writing, remember, is a very strict genre. It's a formal, it's the most, pretty much the most formal genre that you can write in English, and it's very strict, and there are very strict criteria that make it acceptable or not acceptable. And that is really hard for anyone. It's hard for me, it's hard for lots of people. But if you're doing this in a second or foreign language, then a whole new dimension of hard opens up, because there are all kinds of other things. If I'm supposed to do this in German, for example, even though my conversational German is very fluent after living there for so long, academic German is a completely different ballgame. And if I were asked to write articles in academic German, I would feel very uncomfortable and very scared, and I don't think that I would get results. Certainly not in the time frame that they would expect. It might take 10 years for me to produce a decent article in academic German. So I can understand that, and I do understand that there are a whole other dimension when you're writing in English, and that's not necessarily your third language, it may be your second language, it may be your foreign language, depending how your relationship with English. But that's why you have to remember that these challenges, these extra challenges that you face, there are ways to overcome them, especially if you stay motivated and aware of your own particular issue. Okay, so that was just the first thought to start it off. And now I want to try using Padlet. Has anyone used Padlet before? I know it's quite big down in shipping. That's where I actually found out about it, with Dr. When I attended her workshop last semester. And I've been trying to use it ever since. Unfortunately, there was always some problem, like the internet was down, and so on. So that's why we had the boom change to here, because there's less chance of the internet being down in a room in ICTC. However, I'm still struggling with Padlet on my computer. But if you go to that link, there's no www, straight into Padlet, and then that's Frau Boyer, that's my German name. Frau is Mrs. in German. I used to call myself in Germany, so that's my login of the time. So padlet.com/Hangout/English. You should get to something a bit like this. You can do it on your phone or tablet or on the computer if you have it. Hopefully yours is working better than mine. And I've put in a comment already, what word describes how you feel about writing formal or academic English? Now, to add a comment, you can supposedly just double click or hold any part of the wall and add your own comment, okay? So, my season coming up, I'm afraid it doesn't seem to be working on my computer, but I can follow any comments that go up on my phone. So if you want to try, if you've never used Padlet before, just try and hold it down and add a comment. It should be very easy to do. I've got one answer, formal English is intimidating, very good. You don't have to identify yourself here, just can be completely anonymous, just to get some immediate feedback. want to still, if you're still finding your way around that, if you want to add any comments, feel free. There'll be a chance to add comments based on a different question a little bit later on in the minute. But yes, I agree with all those things, and I understand those relationships with academic English, and hopefully we can find ways to overcome any of those negative emotions or feelings or attached to writing in English. Might also be useful for you to think, to have in mind at least one of your current writing projects. If you've got an article that you're preparing for submission, if you're writing at your PhD thesis, like one of the people said, just keep that in mind. I won't come on to that now, but just to be able to share with some prisoners based on your specific writing project that you've got in mind. Okay. So, as I said, well, just first of all, just think about the skills around writing. It's not just the writing itself, sometimes that's just the icing on the cake. But in order to get to that stage, there are various other things that have to be in place. Okay? So I just want to share with you some of those building blocks. Okay? So the first one I've got there is plan and chunk. To be able to write a complex piece of writing, it has to be planned systematically. It can't just be kind of spewed forth like a small essay written the night before. The kind of academic journal writing that's expected of people in our profession is highly structured and therefore requires an incredible amount of planning. And the planning doesn't necessarily have to be about writing. The planning can be in note form, it can be in a different language, not necessarily English, but understanding the different parts and the different parts of the text that you're writing, and being able to plan, and not just plan the writing, but plan your time as well. Good writers usually can be productive even if they've got only an hour or two spare. Okay? Now I find that really hard. Unless I've got the day stretching out ahead of me, I don't really get my creative juices going in time to actually produce any writing that's worthwhile. But I've seen good writers and effective writers say, okay, in 2 hours time I have to go and collect my children, but for those 2 hours I'm going to work on the introduction and I'm going to achieve this. And they do it. And that is amazing. If you are one of those people, then hats off to you. That's incredible. I wish I was more like that. But I know, at least I'm self-aware enough to know that I'm not. And so when I do have a writing project that's reaching the deadline, I know that I need uninterrupted days where I've got hours to let the ideas come and get them pieced together and get that written down. I need uninterrupted hours. And as a mother and a full-time worker, that's sometimes hard to organise, but at least I have the awareness to know that I need that. So you need to be aware of your own self. Are you somebody that can just do some bite-sized hour here, hour there, and be productive, or are you someone who needs those uninterrupted hours? If you have that self-awareness, you can plan accordingly and still get the results that you want and still finish the project that you need to finish. So this kind of self-awareness I'll come back to again too. Okay? Another thing, which I'll come back to time and time again, this is often more advice for students rather than staff and academics like myself. But reading, of course, is essential. If you want to write in a particular genre, you need to read in that genre in order to be able to emulate it in your writing. It doesn't come on its own. Good writing is a process of copying. It's just very advanced copying based on all the things that you've read. Now, of course, as academics, you're reading all the time. You have to read to understand the field that we are working in. So this comes naturally with the work that you are doing. But sometimes I use this to remind students how essential it is to read. And not just read anything, but read in the genre that you are writing in. So that means reading in the discipline and in the field that you're working in, reading everything that is available to read, to understand the style and the tone of that genre. Okay. The next one I put up there is connect. Okay. Now connect it can mean several things. Connecting with other people, with other researchers, with other colleagues in your field, whether it's here at the UPT or around Southeast Asia or around the world. But connecting with other topic, your subject well enough, that does require being an active member of that particular field that you're working in. Although there's a cliche of academics kind of in a dusty office locked away and removed from reality, that's not actually really the case at all. You have to be connected to the network of the people in your field in order to be successful at what you do. But it also means connecting ideas and connecting thoughts. So it's not just connecting with people, it's connecting things together. If you're going to be an effective writer, you need to be able to connect words together, of course, and connect ideas together to make coherent paragraphs in English, and for those paragraphs to be in a structured order that gives the whole text the coherence that it needs. So this kind of idea of connecting is a physical one of connecting with other people and communicating. It's also connecting with your own thought process and being able to put thoughts into words in English and so on. So kind of being open and aware of the amount of connection that you need as a writer. Okay? Next one is reflect. Okay? Now, I work in education too, so again, for the people interested, there's always a lot of things, that, especially for language learning, being reflective learners. Good learners are learners who can reflect on their learning and who can reflect on the learning process. And to raise themselves into that awareness level so that they're aware of their own learning. You can have learners who can go learn a lot and become kind of A-grade students, but they may not be aware of what they're doing. They may just be able to do it because they are good at that subject, okay? But a learner who can go beyond that is one who's aware, and aware that they are aware of the learning process. You can go on and on, aware that they're aware, that they're aware, that they're aware. But this is all to do with reflection. And it's the same for anybody who's trying to write in a very specific genre like academic English, and to be able to reflect on the process and not be kind of tied up in the forest with the trees, but to be able to zoom out and see the whole forest, see the whole process, understand your role in what you're doing, and awareness of how successful you are at that moment with your writing, with a particular section of your report, what you need to do to improve it, to know, okay, well, this is weak because we haven't, the literature review is not thorough enough. So that is what we need to focus on. We need to go back, we need to find more texts that are specific for this article. So this is all to do with reflection and awareness. And again, like I said, these are skills that surround writing, that all these things will make good writing if they are all put together. Okay? Another one I put there is to know their own strengths and weaknesses. So very tied up with reflection as well. But like I've already said, I am aware that I need uninterrupted hours to produce text of any length to get articles finished. I need uninterrupted hours. I cannot do it here, there, an hour here, an hour there. I also cannot work in the evening. Once my children are in bed, it's my time off. And I've tried and I've tried, and when I was writing my PhD thesis, sometimes I had to, but it was really difficult to work in the evening. I struggled so much. Other people can work till 3 a.m. and that's fantastic. And I, you know, again, hats off, but I was aware that that was with me. If I worked 3 a.m, I was sick the next day. I was ill. So it just is not my style. But I knew that, and I knew that once at 9 p.m, I could not work, and I should consider that my time off. Whatever I did had to be in the morning, in the afternoon, or very late in the evening, because I just could not function in the right kind of frame of mind after my children were in bed and so on. So I knew my strengths and my weaknesses, especially that I knew my weakness. Evening work was not for me, working through the night, not for me, okay? But on the other hand, my strengths were that I could be a morning person and I often was very productive in the morning. My children were at school or in childcare, and I could have a clear head and I could focus and get things done, and I could sometimes get done in 2 hours what would take 6 hours later in the day. So that was a strength. But just to do with timing, I was aware of my strengths and weaknesses, and so I didn't have to make myself feel guilty that I didn't work in the evening, because that's one thing that you all know about as writers, academic world, is the guilt when you're not writing, when you're not doing something, you just have that guilt. I should be doing this, and I'm not. I'm having a cup of coffee and a chocolate, and I'm sitting on the sofa, and it's not enjoyable because I feel guilty. And that is not a nice feeling, but if you know your strengths and weaknesses and you play to them, you can eradicate those feelings of guilt, and you can enjoy the time when you're off duty and you know that you're not going to be writing on this day or at this time without that guilty feeling, because otherwise your work-life balance becomes out of sync and you end up not feeling very happy with anything. Okay, so if you know your strengths and your weaknesses, you can play to them and make it work for you, and you can work out when you can be effective and productive with your work and when you can just put it to one side and focus on something else. Okay, so that's some, and it's not just about timing and about work-life balance, you can also know your strengths with your own writing, what you're good at doing. Okay, you can write in this kind of way, you don't have trouble with this kind of section or this type of writing. Other areas you struggle with, but you know how to, then if you identify those, you can find strategies to overcome those weaknesses. So it is all about that awareness. Okay. In a bit of a lime green colour there, but that says work to deadlines, of course. And again, this maybe will be towards students and towards people like yourself, but being able to work to a deadline, it's usually a good thing. And missing deadlines is never a nice feeling for anybody. And often when you're working in research and you're working with other authors, other institutes, there are editors involved, publishers involved, those deadlines are external. And for me, actually, that's the best thing ever. If somebody else who has authority says, this needs to be ready on this day by noon, then I will do it, okay? But if the deadline is not there, then I will not do it. I will do something else, okay? I need external deadlines. I need to work with deadlines. That's the only way I'm productive. And again, with my PhD, that was a struggle because I wasn't on a fixed-term program. My supervisor, my professor, I actually worked for her for her chair. Although I had, I think, 6 semesters as a student, PhD student, it didn't matter if I handed in a year after that or 2 years after that. There was no deadline at all. And at some point, I realised that this was not going to work for me at all. And I said to her, you need to say to me, I'm expecting this chapter on this day, I've cleared my weekend plans just so I can read your chapter, and if you don't provide it, then you'll have ruined my weekend because I've said no to lots of engagements. And she was like, okay, you want me to say that to you? I'm like, yes. And you've got to be convincing. And, okay. So she said, right, I leave this on Friday, and I've cancelled my Saturday plans, and I'm not going to my niece's wedding anymore. Okay, then I can do it. Because I knew that there'd be consequences if I didn't, and that's, I knew that I was a deadline person. And again, there were these productive people that can just do it without the deadline. Well done to them, they're amazing. I think, you know, I wish I could get whatever they've got, but I can't, I need those deadlines. Probably you're the same. So make sure if you are like that, that you can somehow find a way to get somebody else to set you a deadline. Because setting your own deadlines never works. You need to get somebody else to do it, and you need to really believe them. Okay, so again, it's that awareness of that will really, really help. Okay, I put reading in again, because this is the point I was stressing, especially to students, that the relationship between reading and writing is not to be understated, okay? A good reader and a prolific reader is a good writer and a prolific writer. You cannot have one without the other, okay? So there is no shortcut becoming a good writer. It requires actually hours and hours and days of reading, and especially for us in the genre that we write, that we want to write in. So reading academic English will make you able to write academic English. There is no shortcut to it. Reading is just part of the training of becoming an academic English writer. So accepting that there's no shortcut and setting yourself targets of reading 1 or 2 papers per week or book chapters per week, whether or not they're for a literature review or anyway, if you don't want if you're reading and engaging with academic text, you will be becoming better writers. Okay, it's impossible not to. But there is no shortcut. It requires reading page after page after page of academic English. Okay? Oh, there we go again. I'll leave the spiel. I think this might come up one more time. Okay, managing and referencing. Now, we're lucky. We live in the Mendeley age. We live in the EndNote age. We had Satavi in Germany, very similar program. So there is so much software at our disposal. Managing our referencing has become much easier than it used to be. So I don't need to really say too much about this, except that, it's something that can't be sidestepped again. Academic work has to be well referenced for very clear reasons to avoid the abuse of plagiarism, to show sources, and to show that you have read the field in which you are wanting to say something. So academic English requires accurate and appropriate referencing. But we all know that, and nowadays it's actually even easier to keep and manage your referencing in much more straightforward ways, thanks to the software that we have available. Okay, the last one is read. I think I've hopefully motivated you enough already with the things that I've said about reading. I won't say them all again, but reading is really the building block to writing. Okay, the relationship is so strong, there's lots and lots of literature on the relationship between good reading and good writing, if you wanted to look into it. Or you could just believe me, I've read some of it, and you should be reading whatever you need to be reading in your field, which will help make you better writers. Okay, so now that we've thought about those building blocks, you can just spend a few moments reflecting on your own personal strengths and weaknesses. Okay, I've confessed to a lot of mine, and you've probably been thinking, oh yeah, that's true for me, or like, no, I'm not like that, but I have this other problem. Okay, if you want, we can use the Padlet again. Reflect. These are just some ways to think about reflection. Pausing for thought. Being mindful is a very popular concept these days. Meta-awareness, so awareness of awareness, being aware that you are aware. And awareness itself. Okay, so these are all very important, again, important academic skills for being successful as academic writers. And now we could use the Padlet, and you can think of, again, this is anonymous, you can just type something in. I wish that my computer was working so that I could clear the board up a bit. I might try. But you could just add something to yourself. You can do it anonymously. I would just be really interested to see what one of those skills or another skill do you consider to be something that you do well. Just choose one. Anything that you think is an area of weakness for you that you want to work on. Okay, have a go. I'll see what comes up. As I was talking to these, but is there any that you consider to be a particular strength of yours, or any that you consider to be a particular weakness? For time management, we've got, remember this is anonymous, your name, nothing comes up related to you, so you don't feel that you will be picked out and ridiculed for your honesty.
Procrastinator,
the far end. No. Can you like go that way? Yeah. Yeah. Like it should be on my phone. You will go that way. Yeah. I'm not sure what it is. Why not refresh?
Easy side track, yeah.
And then you go that way.
I'm always putting the kettle on and being a British cliche, making another
one. On the phone, yeah.
Reading is always fun, yeah, that's true. And it's less, there's no pressure. When you're reading, you've not got the pressure of writing. Writing is a performance. Writing is putting part of you onto a page. Reading is letting something else come to you. It's less, there's less pressure. It can be more relaxing. It doesn't have to be as intense an experience, actually. So we should really make time. Organising references, good. Collecting articles, yes. Trying to be systematic in how we store the reading that we want to do. That's also a very good skill. Quickly aware of which sections of writing are bad and why they're bad. That's very good. That's very good. Somebody there is a born editor as well. Being able to spot the kind of weak areas of a text and so on. Okay, somebody said they go reading letters and so hopefully my inspirational, motivational speeches will have some effect. Analysis paralysis, I like that. Analysis paralysis. Yeah, so kind of, okay, I've got this data, I should be analysing it. I paralyze. Yeah, I can sympathize with that too. Finding the right article. Good. Yeah, and the one before that, I love writing. Once I get started, that is. Okay, another procrastinator. Very good. Yeah. And then just write for filling up into nine. And that's under week that's under seven. Yes, that's good. To have something on the page is better than nothing. If you've written something, then the next day you can always go back and start from there. But if you only have a blank page, then you go back the next day and you still only have a blank page. So if you've had an unsuccessful few hours, the least you can do is just put down two sentences. Because then the next day at least you've got something to go back to and you will build on that. But building on a blank page is really hard. Publish or perish. Yeah. Okay. And then some more weaknesses. Planning and structuring. Time is just not with me. Yes, yes. Poor time management. Yes. Finding the most suitable evidence to support my point. Yes. So more reading or more focused reading to find the evidence that you need. And having things accessible is limited. I struggle with online access for articles and wishing that I could just get things more easily than I can. And not wanting to subscribe to 20 different journals at my own cost is quite hard. Pomodoro writing technique. I need to hear what this actually is. Sounds interesting. Doing part-time, yes. Part-time is really hard. Because when it comes to very big writing projects, like PhD thesis, it cannot, at some point, it can't be part-time. It's something that has to take over. And I found out to my family's disadvantage. Okay, good. Yeah, I'm sorry I can't show them on here, so we can all see them, but you should be able to see them coming in on your own device. Okay. Summarizing findings without compromising reading. Yeah. So summarizing and paraphrasing either what somebody else has said or what you have said, summarizing your own work into a conclusion and so on. We'll be looking a little bit at kind of paraphrasing skills in a minute. Okay, good. That was really interesting for me as well to see your thoughts about that. So thank you. Let's get through here. So thank you for sharing those with me. We will obviously near the end we'll have more of an open discussion. I think this is just sometimes it's quite a nice format that people don't feel like they have to kind of put their hand up like a school or be on the spot. You can just type it and kind of suits today's day and age. So yeah, that was like I like that. Okay. you all to only using the Padlet wall. Does anybody want to say anything out loud? Or is everyone okay just now? Okay just now? Yeah, okay. So, we're going to be looking at kind of five things that are worthy of looking at as far as I'm concerned. These things come up as big queries among native speakers of English who are trying to write in the academic genre. So this isn't just necessarily the second language speakers, this is for everybody. And these are some of the really common hair pulling out, I don't know what to do. It may, like I said, I may have pitched this at the wrong level, this may be more of a kind of master student level. Feel free to tell me, but hopefully you will learn something or something will suddenly make more sense than it did before. Okay? So looking at the first person use. Be or not to be. There was a study in 2015, so very recent, which analysed the advice and influential style guides of Boston. According to the APA disposition in 2010, which is the one that we use at UBD certainly in class, and I don't know about the science, the natural science, but the APA disposition is pretty much the standard accepted style guide to follow. In my area. And the use of the first person at the act point is actually advocated. People think that the first person should be avoided, and it's very stressful to try and avoid it. But actually, if you look at the style guide, it says it's okay. You can use it, especially to ensure the clarity of authorship and direct and understandable text. Because when you try and think of alternatives, and people used to write things like, the author's thing, meaning I, but if you've just been talking about other authors, then it's not clear, are you actually referring to Byron that you just used as a reference, or are you referring to yourself? So people then just start to say like the current authors, or the present author, or the authors of this study, but again, it's sometimes unclear. And so the APA style guide actually says to avoid this, it's actually preferable use the first person. It used to be considered a way to sound more objective if you took out the subject, I. Okay, but actually this is a bit of a myth that's taken years and years and years to actually eradicate this myth. But I think we are getting somewhere now. And the use of the first person is not a crime in academic writing, and it is actually actively encouraged. Okay? The Z concludes that in general, writing the first person and active voice is preferred. Okay, he didn't just look at APA, he looked at lots of other style guides too, and he came to the conclusion that it was generally preferred. The advice of the academic advisor or publication editor should be taken into account, however, and this is the correct advice in each specific case. So if you're writing for a journal that says, no, we don't want the first person, that's the advice you should follow, not the advice on this slide. Okay? At the end, it should always be the editor, the publisher, or the specific requirements from the journal that you're writing for, and they do differ, so you have to check that out. You have to be aware, for one journal, it could be a different set of rules to the next. So you have to be sure, and there'll be an editor that you can contact if you're not sure. They will send you a style guide where it sets it all out very clearly. Okay? So this is probably the most important thing to remember with the first person. There are personal preferences. There is the style guide which recommends certain rules of clarity, but at the end of the day, your editor for that particular project, your publisher for that particular project should have the final say. Okay. So according to the APA disposition, the first person is prescribed for author action. So not only is it kind of generally recommended in the disposition, it actually says you have to use the first person when you're talking about what you are doing as an author. So if you're describing your methodology, instead of saying the study was designed or the research was designed in the following way, say I designed the research in the following way, and that's okay. It used to be like, oh no, too much subject, too much I, it's not academic. Nowadays, that really has been disproved. Okay? But again, do make sure you're aware who you're writing for and what their preference is, because there are still people that ask for certain. Okay, so this is to do with the first person. So For example, in the surveys were analysed and coded first inductively and then deductively according to the question asking. That would, if you're following the APA guide, that would actually be considered wrong, and it would be preferable to say, I analysed and coded the surveys first inductively and then deductively according to the question asking. Okay, but adding using the subject of the person would be preferred according to APA. And then there's a quote from the APA style blog, a really useful website which deals with a lot of these interesting grey areas in academic English. I can recommend it. I'm often asked why APA style pivots to use I or E. I love this question because the answer is always a pleasant surprise. I or E is perfectly acceptable in APA style. In fact, the publication manual actually recommends using first person when appropriate to avoid ambiguity. Okay? So, I don't know, yeah, maybe that makes you feel angry, but we were always told not to. Or maybe it makes you feel vindicated. Yes, this is what I believe and it's now correct. But this is just what I found out through research, that there's a specific study analysing the different style guides. But this is the latest advice. It's not even necessarily the advice that we give students at the Language Centre, but I will be doing what I can to kind of try and update the advice that we give to students based on the most current advice from APA. Ultimately, that is what we follow at the Language Centre. Yeah? Okay. So, that may have like challenged your ideas or it may have confirmed them. Next one is the data. Is it singular or is it plural? Okay, this is something that, again, you see time and time again in both ways in the reading. You see things like this data and you see these data. And again, maybe it's just me, but I used to see a lot more this data, and now I'm seeing more of it used as a plural, these data. Well, according to the APA, data is the plural form of the noun, and datum is the singular, because it's from Latin. Okay? So that's a classic way to pluralize a noun in Latin, data, A at the end, and singular form datum. Okay? So the APA style, again, which is kind of what we believe to be the hard truth, advocates the use of data as a plural noun, and therefore one which should be accompanied by plural forms of verbs and pronouns. Okay? So in that case, this data reveals a broad trend. Would that be right or wrong according to APA? Wrong. Yeah. So according to APA, we need to use the plural pronoun these instead of this, and then the accompanying verb reveal, not it reveals that they, it would be they reveal, which is the plural form. So these data reveal a broad trend. Now again, from 20 years ago, that would not have rolled off my tongue. I would have been much more likely to say this data reveals, thinking of data as a kind of uncountable whole, would be how I always visualize this concept of data. So this is something that I have to overcome. And when I was proofreading my own thesis and so on, there was a lot of times that I had to change from this data to these data and so on, to make it consistent and to make it according to what the APA advised. Okay? So I did actually do that and made these changes, but even my own supervisor sometimes says, oh, that looks funny, and I go, oh no, it's right. So this is really kind of a change that we're seeing, and the more that it's that we conform, and the more that everybody does it, the better actually. So yeah. It is a change for me, it's something I do have to get used to. It doesn't come naturally to say these data is real. But more and more I hope it will, the more I get used to it. Yes?
Is it the same for information?
No, information is a singular concept. This information, yeah. And you can't add an S to information. other information that would be considered not standard English, you would say this piece of information or these pieces of information. Information always stays without an S. It's called an uncountable noun. But it does take a singular pronoun and verb. Okay, this information is, not these information are. That would be wrong. Okay? So that's, yeah, really good question. Thank you for asking. Do feel free to jump in with questions. I'm really happy to answer.
What about research? I'm sorry. Oh, this one is research.
Okay, so this research, you can't say researchers.
Yeah.
You cannot. Yeah, you can't say researchers. You have to say this research or this research and or these research studies or these research questions. You can ask countable nouns after research, cannot actually turn it into a plural on its own, okay? So these research questions, fine. But these researchers, not fine. Okay, you need something actually at the end. Okay. So in this case then, choosing the correct form should be easy now. The data regarding age, show or shows?
Show. kind of text that you're writing as researchers in the field.
when it comes to conclusions. The present perfect example is here. Okay? So that I've just stuck to two and then just one of the tense, the present simple and the past simple. Now you do find the use of will, future will, in academic texts, sometimes in abstracts. This paper will do this and will do that. But often it's written in the present. The present already has, the present simple has a future component to it. You can use the present.